Hi, my name is Julie Collini. I'm a computer science PhD student at Stanford University, and I'm excited to be talking about our paper, Mission Impossible Language Models.
One of this year's ACL 2024 Best Paper Awards went to the authors of the Mission Impossible Language Models paper. This paper claims to prove Chomsky wrong by providing evidence against his claim that LLMs are incapable of distinguishing the possible from the impossible. I brought Ms. Coffee Bean along to the ACL conference in Bangkok, which saw over 4,000 attendees. The event was packed with exciting scientific and social activities, including two Muay Thai boxing matches. During the conference, we first met Julie Collini, the lead author of the award-winning paper, by chance at breakfast. We'll give you a first-hand look at her poster session and offer our thoughts on the Mission Impossible Language Models paper. So grab a cup of coffee and let's talk about impossible languages. Let's put the paper in a nutshell. Noam Chomsky, a renowned linguist who revolutionized the field in the 1950s by treating language as a uniquely human trait, has long been skeptical of language models. His main critique of LLMs is rooted in this perspective. He argues that while humans can naturally distinguish between impossible and possible languages, LLMs are incapable of distinguishing the possible from the impossible. He is not the only one making such claims. Bolhuis et al. Go so far as to claim that LLMs can produce impossible languages just as well as, if not better, than natural language output. So Julia Collini and collaborators decided to put Chomsky's claim to the test. Defining an impossible language is challenging, but they approach this rigorously by creating a continuum of impossibility. This ranged from an existing language, namely English, to more and more complex constructs such as count-based grammar rules, where specific markers like number or tense are placed four tokens after the verb. They also explored reversed strings and, as the farthest of the end of the spectrum goes, random word shuffles representing the most impossible language. If we are to believe Chomsky and his colleagues, LLMs trained from scratch on these languages wouldn't struggle to model the entire spectrum. However, the study's findings suggest otherwise. The more impossible the language, the harder it was for a GPT-2 model to learn it when trained from scratch on data from the language, and the higher its perplexity at the end of training was. Now let's see the author's presentation showing the evidence, and then I'll share my opinion on the paper.
The paper is Mission Impossible Language Models, and what we set out to do was test what can language models learn just from data. In particular, like, we were kind of responding to certain claims made in the linguistics community about language models being able to learn impossible languages. These are languages that humans wouldn't be able to learn. And the claims that have been made are that language models cannot distinguish between possible and impossible languages and can learn them equally well. The problem is that these claims haven't actually been tested, so we set out to have a framework that can actually put these claims to the test. So what exactly are, like, possible and impossible languages? This really doesn't have a clear answer, but if we, like, look at the theoretical linguistics literature, we know that human languages are hypothesized to have these hierarchical syntactic structures. This is just one example of an impossible language, but you can imagine introducing, like, some rule into language where that kind of, like, violates the hierarchical structure entirely. So things like counting, like here in English, we have, like, verbs and are represented, the tense is represented by this S suffix. What if that suffix just appeared exactly like two words later? This would be very easy to describe and very systematic, but impossible for a human baby to acquire. This is just one example, and we test on a whole, like, continuum of languages that have differing complexity, thinking both about, like, their information theoretic attributes as well as, like, their formal linguistic characteristics. And I've laid out all of the impossible languages, the synthetic impossible languages that we came up with. We have, like, three classes. So shuffle languages have different shuffles of English sentences. The reverse languages involve different reversals of the English sentences. And the hop languages are like this one that I described here, where we have like the verb tense being marked by a token that appears some distance away from the verb. And in this case, we use like, in this language, we had like four tokens away versus like four words away. And in our experimental setup, what we did was we create a synthetic impossible language data set by manipulating an English corpus in a specific way to make it impossible, and then train a GPT-2 small model from scratch just on that one synthetic language. And to give the overview, like the first metric that we kind of looked at just to see how well is each impossible language learned by GPT-2 was just perplexity. And this is like the layout for like all the shuffle languages, but I'll just point your attention to like the English case is the easiest for GPT-2 to learn across the board. And that was the same across all three classes of languages. So I also have the hop language here. So English is this bottom line that I have in the graph. Easiest for GPT-2 to learn, at least by measuring perplexity across training steps. We did a deep dive on the specific set of hop languages that have that marker that uses this counting rule. And we did that using surprisals. This is the second experiment that I'll go into right here. So surprisal is just the negative log probability of a token. And we took like the sentences that have the marker token. We can get its surprisal. We also created these sets of ungrammatical sentences by removing the marker and taking the token that would appear next to it. So you can think of this as like, what would the model think if the marker didn't appear where it's supposed to? In the case number one, if the rule is properly learned, then this surprisal should be small. It should learn to expect where these markers appear. And in case number two, the surprisal difference between the next token and the marker token should be large. You can imagine it would be very surprised if we didn't actually put the token where it's supposed to. And in both cases, the control model did the best. So it was the control model had the lowest surprisals for the marker token and the highest surprisal difference in this case across training steps. So that just indicates that at least GPT-2 preferred the natural grammar rule.
So are these findings surprising? Not to Miss Coffee Bean, at least. I came across the paper on Twitter long before ACL and I wasn't baffled at all. Why? Because as we move further along the impossibility spectrum, the patterns become increasingly complex, eventually turning random. So what happens here is that this spectrum raises the entropy of the language. In simpler terms, the language becomes more and more unpredictable. It's no surprise that any model, whether a human brain or a GPT language model, would struggle more and more with higher entropy. The more random the language, the higher the theoretically expected perplexity. While Chomsky insists that language is uniquely human, a view that I don't fully agree with, I agree that we do find common ground in that languages should follow consistent patterns, the simpler the better. This is what makes them learnable. Low entropy in style and grammar is essential for effectively communicating the message. And it is the message, so the content, which is usually high entropy and high perplexity to the receiver of the message if there are to receive new information. Every model, whether human or LLM, needs a language structure that keeps entropy within limits. When randomness and high entropy take over, the message becomes nearly impossible to understand for the receiver and more difficult for the sender to produce. The perplexity baseline does naturally rise, and I wouldn't have needed this paper experiment to believe that. But to make the author's point, the more impossible the language, the sooner the curves reach a plateau. So, while these findings were expected to me, the fact that the ACL community of reviewers and chairs chose to award this paper a Best Paper Award suggests that others saw a need for clarity on whether claims from linguists like Chomsky are well-founded or not. The paper committee cited these reasons, to which I agree. A paper presenting very clever experiments, testing and rejecting the hypothesis that LLMs are linguistically uninteresting devices because they could learn all kinds of grammars, including impossible ones. While the range of models and tests could be expanded, the paper is very clear, pleasant to read, it comes with convincing analysis, and it addresses central issues in the current debate in theoretical linguistics. Ah, and if you're wondering why they trained only GPT-2, because their experiments involved training an LLM from scratch to see if it learns or doesn't learn the language, they chose GPT-2 because GPT-2 is something that us mere mortals can keep training while the cost does not explode. Please read the paper to see if it convinces you. It's very well written and a nice read. I hope you liked this little nugget of information we brought from the ACL, and thanks for watching. And to enjoy your coffee breaks with our next videos, don't forget to hit the like and subscribe buttons. Okay, bye.